Mamma mia!
That's viral video from just this month, March 2023. Trapped miners in the Democratic Republic of Congo scrambling out of a hole from a collapsed mine to the cheers of their fellow Congolese who know just how rare this moment is to actually survive a mine accident in the Congo. These were gold miners, but the manner in which they mine, digging with their hands, with rudimentary tools in dusty, dangerous conditions, the same techniques used by miners after a natural resource of another kind. It's cobalt, and it's essential to something that you may very well have in your hands right now. There is blood on our smartphones, according to today's guest, who says that the cobalt mined under the most dangerous, subhuman, toxic conditions is mined for us. We are the end users of that cobalt because it is essential in the operation of our rechargeable batteries, in our smartphones, our tablets and laptops, and in our electric vehicles. Our next guest has been on the ground where the cobalt is mined in the Congo, and he says the miners, the poor, and the children exist, as he puts it, at the edge of human life in an environment that is treated like a toxic dumping ground by foreign mining companies. Those words from the book, Cobalt Red: How the Blood of the Congo Powers Our Lives. The author is Siddharth Kara, Senior Fellow at the Harvard School of Public Health, Associate Professor of Human Trafficking and Modern Slavery at Nottingham University, and Adjunct Professor at UCLA. Professor Kara, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Frank.
I want to understand why we need this cobalt. We gave you a sense of how it's used in the technology, but why it has to be mined in this way, and specifically in the Democratic Republic of Congo?
Well, cobalt is an essential element to almost every rechargeable battery made in the world today. So as you rightfully noted, all the smartphones, gadgets, and so on, and including electric vehicles, cobalt allows those batteries to hold maximum charge and remain thermally stable. What does that mean? You don't have to plug in as often. Mm. There's more cobalt sitting under the dirt in the Congo than the rest of the planet combined. Mm. In fact, last year, the Congo produced around 3/4 of the world's supply of cobalt. So we all need cobalt to function. You and I can't function for 24 hours without cobalt, and almost all of the world's supply is coming from the Congo, mined in horrible conditions.
We have so many natural resources here in the United States. We don't have cobalt?
There's a small amount of cobalt. It's lower grade. There's a small amount in places like Australia, Russia, Morocco. But the Congo, by virtue of just pure geographic fluke, is sitting on a treasure chest of cobalt deposits.
And talk to us about, I gave an overview based on your book of what you have seen on the ground, but give us some detail. Take us inside the mining process. Tell us who is doing it.
There are hundreds of thousands of some of the poorest people in the world, including tens of thousands of children, scrounging and scrambling every day to pull cobalt out of the ground and feed it up the supply chain into our gadgets and cars. So they use pickaxes, shovels, rebar, and bare hands in an utter hellscape of chewed up earth. And cobalt is toxic to touch and breathe. So there are women with babies strapped to their backs, hacking at the ground, and everyone, including those infants, is breathing these toxic particulates. So people are being contaminated every day. They suffer horrific injuries with pit wall collapses and tunnel collapses. It's a complete catastrophe at the bottom of these supply chains.
And those are sort of the physical things that one can see. Do we have any sense of the long-term health effects that some of these people are suffering?
Well, already there's a public health pandemic taking place relating to cobalt toxic exposure. Cancers are spreading, birth defects, thyroid disease, respiratory ailments, acute dermatitis. The people who are living in that area, even if they don't have anything to do with cobalt mining, are still being contaminated every day by cobalt mining. And that part of the world, the Congo, being one of the poorest countries in the world, they don't have lots of hospitals and public health clinics to treat people. So in every conceivable way, There's an enormous violence being inflicted on this population of people just to support our rechargeable lives.
You are an expert in slavery and human trafficking. When you first arrived on the scene to see with your own eyes what you had no doubt read about and heard about, can you just tell me how it affected you?
I have done research in dozens of countries on slavery and child labor, and I've seen the ugliest aspects of humanity. And on my first trip to the Congo, when I went to the first mining area, I was hit by a thunderclap of misery. The people there scrounging over the earth, they looked like human beings, but their situation was so bleak and grim. The earth had been destroyed, millions of trees clear cut, water polluted, air polluted. It's like the clock had been dialed back centuries to a time when people and earth could just be obliterated for the profit of powerful stakeholders up the chain.
Some people, I suspect, might say, look, this is at least opportunity for them. They are paid for the work, as little as it may be, they are paid. This is something instead of nothing. To that, you would say what?
On that given day, the dollar or two they earn for this miserable, hazardous work does mean the difference between eating or not. That does not justify it ethically or morally. It means our economic system, our global economic order, has failed these people, that they've been forced into a position where they have to scrounge out this base existence for a dollar or two a day, when the companies at the top of the chain are swimming in money. So it doesn't make it okay just because they survive on this meager income. We have to do better to give them a decent and dignified existence.
And whose fault is it? Is it the government of the Democratic Republic of Congo? Is it these companies who take the refined cobalt? Is it us, the people who use smartphones and devices that require cobalt?
Well, we've been made unwitting participants in this enormous violence. You know, when you and I buy our smartphone or our laptop and we plug in our electric car, we don't think we are contributing to enormous violence against the people and environment of the Congo. So we've been forced to participate in this. Who's responsible? One of the tragedies is no one's accepting responsibility for what's happening to the people of the Congo and the environment around them. Demand for cobalt starts at the top of the chain, and that's where accountability has to start. The whole blood for cobalt value chain wouldn't exist if it weren't for the demand created at the top. So that's where responsibility lies fundamentally.
And you're talking about the major technology companies that use this.
I'm talking about mega cap tech companies, EV companies, anyone that makes a gadget or car with a lithium ion rechargeable battery in it. That's where demand starts. And there are bad actors all the way down the chain, but everything is a consequence of the demand that starts at the top.
And as you know, because of your area of expertise, mining is never a pretty thing. And the people who mine it, whether it's the coal miners in West Virginia and Kentucky or the cobalt miners in Africa, they suffer. And it is a difficult and horrific thing. Where does cobalt mining, and how does it compare to mining, for example, in the United States?
There's one very important thing we have to understand about what's happening with cobalt mining today. And today is the important word, because we're living in a time where we all ascribe to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and we have sustainability principles, which wouldn't have been the case a century ago with coal mining. What's happening right now in the Congo, in the whole history of slavery and colonial pillage, there has never been an instance in which there is more human degradation and suffering that is generating more profit at the top of the chain and touching the lives of more people around the world. That's what makes this worse than anything that's happened before. It's today, our moral standards today, and yet those principles have been jettisoned in the face of this scramble to profit, and the people of the Congo and their environment are the expense account.
We're going to take a short break. We know what the cobalt mining conditions are like. So how can companies change? Are they willing to change? We'll ask after the break.
The future of mobility is, as you know, electric, unleashed within the ultimate driving machine.
Is the Ram 1500 Revolution battery electric concept vehicle. A stunning vision of Ram's future.
Just a couple of the latest EV models being announced this year at the Consumer Electronics Show. The rechargeable batteries used in electric cars, smartphones, tablets, and laptops, all powered by cobalt mined in the Democratic Republic of Congo. We're back with the author of Cobalt Red, How the Blood of the Congo Powers Our Lives, Siddharth Akara. I want to ask you about a lawsuit filed in 2019 against Apple's five technology companies, Apple, Tesla, Dell, Microsoft, and the parent of Google, Alphabet, about the children being injured and killed by cobalt mining in the Congo. The lawsuit was thrown out by a federal judge last summer. He essentially said they had no standing, that there was no, as he put it, traceable harm. He said the only real connection between these companies and these people who are mining, these children in this case, is that the companies buy refined cobalt. Was the judge wrong in that ruling?
It's hard for me to understand the argument that there's no connection between tech and EV companies and the cobalt being mined in the Congo, because it's all being mined for them. It's not going anywhere else except into gadgets and electric vehicles. So there's a link. It may pass through various levels of a supply chain and thousands of miles around the world, but eventually and inevitably, the cobalt being scrounged out of the ground in the Congo ends up in the products sold to us every day by tech and EV companies. So I think we have to reimagine how we ascribe accountability, because when you say that the company at the top of the chain is not responsible for conditions at the bottom, what you're basically saying is it's a free-for-all out there. Any company can go into any shadowy labor market around the world and get their shirts knitted or get their coffee harvested or get their cobalt mined, and it can be done in slave-like conditions, and they're not responsible. Mm.
The companies at least present publicly this sense that they are trying to do the right thing. You cite some examples of statements that they have put out. I want to share one of them with our viewers on TV and our listeners on the audio podcast. This is a statement that you have in your book from Tesla. To assure the cobalt in Tesla's supply chain is ethically sourced, we have implemented targeted due diligence procedures for cobalt sourcing. So when we as consumers read that, we think, okay, they're doing the right thing. And there are parts of these associations that we've heard about that are about ethical mining and ethical labor standards. Is any of that true?
No. I mean, I'm sure they have targeted due diligence standards, whatever that combination of words means. But does it translate into anything on the ground in the Congo, where the cobalt is coming from? Not that I've ever seen. And if you speak to anyone down there in the Congo, they'll tell you the same thing. You see, the whole history of slavery and child labor and colonial pillage has a common theme. There are fictions told at the top of the chain about what's happening at the bottom. And it takes truth seekers to go down to the bottom to reveal, wait a minute, none of that is true. In fact, there's horror taking place here. And that is what truth seekers have to bring out into the world. And then there's this need to reconcile. Well, you said the conditions are okay and your policies are zero tolerance policies on child labor and so forth. Well, how come there are thousands of children digging your cobalt out of the ground?
And these associations that we've heard about that are supposed to protect against this, these companies subscribe to these associations and say, see, we are ensuring that ethical practices are followed. On the ground there, you found what?
Never heard of them. Never saw them on the ground doing anything. And nor did anyone else in the Congo, none of my colleagues. You know, there's this entire machinery of putting out this fiction and maybe trying to appease shareholders and consumers and government regulators that the companies are doing what they need to do. And so it all ultimately crumbles in the face of the ground truth. And that's why I make it a point to say, if these companies are serious about cleaning up their supply chains and ensuring human dignity all the way down to the mining level, get on the ground yourself. Put your boots on the ground and see with your own eyes what's happening at the bottom of your supply chain.
To that point, you reached out directly to Elon Musk on Twitter and said, I will help you. How did he respond?
I have heard nothing. Crickets from all of them. I have made an open invitation. Any CEO of any tech or EV company that wants to see the bottom of their supply chain, I will take you there. I will show you what's happening on the ground, how the children, caked in toxic filth and grit, are pulling your cobalt out of the ground, how mothers pound their chest in grief when their sons were buried alive in a tunnel collapse, husbands killed with pit wall collapses, children suffering shattered spines. It's all there for anyone to see. These CEOs are multi-billionaires many times over on the backs of this cobalt. Surely they could find 1 week out of their busy schedules to come with me to the Congo and see for themselves where these great fortunes are being built.
Could this stop overnight if the companies, even one of them, said, we're no longer going to accept these practices? Or if together they said, we are no longer going to accept these practices, would that force the government to institute some sort of procedures and protections for these miners?
You know, individually and certainly collectively, these companies have enormous market power. And the market economy can do wonderful things if you decide to employ the power of buying, your buying power. So if they said tomorrow, we're going to get boots on the ground and we're going to make sure everything is done to meet human rights standards or else we're going to stop buying this cobalt, things would happen. And that's the tragedy here. That's the great tragedy, that none of this misery needs to be taking place. None of these children need to be dying. All it takes is the desire at the top of the chain to understand and take responsibility for conditions at the bottom. And so the question is, the final question here is, well, why don't they do it? Why don't they think those people over there are worth it? Is it because it's those people over there and not our people over here? We wouldn't send the children of Cupertino to scrounge in toxic pits for cobalt. Why is it okay to send the children of the Congo?
Your book has generated headlines around the world. People know this issue now because of you. Have you heard from any of them? Have any of the companies stepped up and said, you know, Siddharth, we want to do the right thing?
My phone lines are open. I have not received communications from any of them as of yet. Maybe they think it will all just sort of blow over and they can get back to business as usual. But I think something's happening. The world has learned about a horror that they were unwittingly forced to participate in. And I think there's outrage. I think there's a great deal of emotional awareness that's emerging from this, and people are going to clamor for change.
All right. On that note, after the footage that you have now seen, you may be wondering, how can I help? How can I help to fix this issue? We're going to ask that question after the break. And welcome back. We're back with the author of Cobalt Red, How the Blood of the Congo Powers Our Lives. One more question about this idea of technology companies and then our complicity. It's easy to blame the technology companies and say, well, they're the bad guys. Am I the bad guy? I mean, I'm using a cell phone. This is my smartphone right here. If I drive an electric car, if I use a laptop, is there something I can do to say, I don't want my cobalt mined in this way? I don't want people to be abused.
The power is in our hands now. The world has learned of a horror. And throughout the history of human rights, change happens through a system. First, truth comes out. People learn of a horror. And then people of conscience band together and say, this injustice cannot stand, and we're not going to stop clamoring and agitating until change happens. So yes, as individuals, we have to spread awareness. And we can make choices. Do we need to upgrade our phone every year? Or can we survive with the same phone for a few years? If we buy an electric vehicle, fine. But now we're an owner of a car, and we have a responsibility to then clamor for change and ask those companies to ensure that their supply chains are untainted by child labor, forced labor, and this horrific atrocity that's taking place in the Congo.
You said that none of the big technology companies have reached out to you in response. Do you have a sense that some of those things you're talking about are starting to happen? Has there been any reaction that gives you hope that there could be change on the horizon?
I've received thousands, maybe tens of thousands of emails and messages on social media since the publication of Cobalt Red 2 months ago. Almost all of them have the following message. I am shocked. I had no idea. I can't believe this is happening in 2023. So that gives me hope that that outrage, that indignation, that sense of injustice is going to take shape into a movement that will not yield until this injustice is set right.
All right. Once again, the book is Cobalt Red, How the Blood of the Congo Powers Our Lives. Siddharth Kara, thank you for spending some time with us and for your work on this very important issue.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us and watching. We'll have more on the audio podcast that drops on Wednesdays. We'll see you next time. Thank you.